Well, good morning, everybody. Mothers, happy Mother's Day. Pray that you guys have a blessed day today. Would you stand with us as we sing the first song?
The Lord shall cause his glorious voice to be heard, and you shall have a song in the night. Come to the mountain of the Lord, see his glory and his might. He's the mighty one of Israel, the mighty one of Israel. His voice shall be heard in the power.
To the Lord in prayer. Lord, we praise you this morning. Lord, we lift you up in praise, Lord. Lord, we just welcome you here this morning. Have your way in this place, Lord. We pray that you would just dwell amongst us today. Lord, we just pray blessings over this service. Pray for Pastor Eric as he brings the sermon. Lord, we pray for healing and deliverance, Lord God, from through the sermon you've given him today. Lord, bless this day and all we do, Lord, as we're honoring our moms today, Lord. Lord, I pray that they all just feel blessed and loved, Lord. And Lord, everything they do, everywhere we go, Lord, we just pray that you would be a hedge today, Lord God. We pray for reunions and getting together with family and everything that goes on going out to eat, Lord. We just pray for a blessed time today for them. Lord, have your way with us this week as we leave this place, Lord, that your light would so shine through us, Lord, that we'd be ready at every moment, Lord God, to preach the good news to those around us. Lord, we just thank and praise you for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Psalm 72, verse 18 and 19. Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who only does wondrous things. And blessed be his glorious name forever. And let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen.
Blessed be your name. Thank you.
Psalms 23, verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me.
Prayer Sunday, And we're going to, if you're in need of prayer, we're going to have groups in the back of the church praying. So if you have a need for prayer, we invite you to go to the back for prayer. See here, Psalm 66, starting with verse 1. Make a joyful shout to God, all the earth. Sing out the honor of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your works. Through the greatness of your power, your enemies shall submit themselves to you. All the earth shall worship you and sing praises to you. They shall sing praises to your name. Selah. Again, we invite you for prayer if you're needing prayer. You can stay standing or you can be seated if you'd like. Psalm 16, verse 7 through 11. I will bless the Lord who guides me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I know the Lord is always with me, and I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. No wonder my heart is glad and I rejoice. My body rests in safety, for you will not leave my soul among the dead, or allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. You will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence and the pleasures living with you forever. This song, you say, it's a Lauren Daigle song, and it's really a good ministering song, you know, being cooped up in the house all these months and just going through different things. And you know, and sometimes you hear these different, you know, you feel like, man, you know, what's going on with my life? You know, things seem like they're going really slow. And sometimes you don't feel worthy at times too, for different things, you know. But, you know, as that scripture said, that the Lord is with us. He is our safety. He will not let us rot in the grave. He will always be with us. He will never leave you nor forsake you. So just always continue to hold on to Jesus. Just call out to him. And these words, as we sing these words of the song, they really just minister to you as you sing them. So I pray blessings over you as you sing this song. And just sing it with your heart. Sing it to the Lord. 6. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled.
Jesus.
Lord, we praise you this morning. We lift you up. We thank you, Lord God, for being with us, Lord. We pray, Lord God, that this praise, Lord God, has reached you, Lord God, and that it is a sweet aroma, Lord God, to you. Lord, we just bless your holy name. Lord, I just pray for healing. I pray for deliverance, Lord. I pray that you would set people free, Lord. I pray, Lord God, if there are people here that don't know you and know the free gift of salvation of your shed blood, Jesus, that you would prick their hearts today, Lord God. Open the eyes of their hearts to you. Lord, we pray for an encounter, Lord God, between you and them today. Lord, just thank you. Thank you, Lord God, for loving us. Thank you for carrying us through, Lord God, even the dark times, Lord. Thank you for carrying us and blessing us through the high times too, Lord. Lord, I just thank you for always being with us, Lord, because you said you'd never leave us nor forsake us. And Lord, we just thank you for never letting go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Calvary. And a happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there today. Hope you're having a blessed day. A few announcements this morning. It's kind of short. If you didn't miss the annual meeting a couple weeks ago, there still are some annual reports on the table back by the mailboxes. If you'd like to grab one of those and just kind of read through, it's the financial reports, it's business stuff, but there's also a lot of ministry stuff in there. A lot of people wrote reports about what's been going on in the last year. It's kind of encouraging. I encourage you, if you have not done that or have not read your report, to take a little time just to breeze through that. Big thank you to those who took down and set up from the blood mobile list last week, and thank you to anybody who gave blood. Things are kind of winding down into the summer mode here a little bit. Adult Sunday school is now done for the summer. Small groups, this will be the last week of small groups before we take a summer break. And Wednesday night youth group and King's Kids are winding down. May 19th will be their last meeting. So, and looking ahead for summer, that last announcement on there too, put on your calendars. We're planning a family camp. Get together at Big Stone Camp for Christ. Hopefully you can make summer all of that. And the dates for that are August 13th to 15th. So try to keep that open. And we weren't able to do that last year, but we're looking forward to a great time together this year. So with that, I'll turn it over to Pastor Eric.
Thanks, Jeff. Good morning, everybody. Together here at Calvary, we are living life to the full and
looking forward to the goal
of meeting Jesus in heaven. Yes, thanks for gathering with me this morning to honor the Lord on this beautiful day. Welcome, first-time attenders. Awesome. And friends and visitors, good to have you with us today. You might be a mom if your phone contains 300 blurry photos of inanimate objects that your preschooler took. Am I right, Maya and Greta? You might be a mom if you haven't gone to the bathroom by yourself in over a year. You might be a mom if you do 3 loads of laundry every single day and you still can't catch up. I think I heard an amen on that one. You might be a mother if your refrigerator doubles as an art display, if you catch yourself singing Let It Go in the grocery aisle. You might be a mom if you could serve a full meal with the food that's on the floor of your car. You might be a mom if you've ever told someone you get what you get and you don't pitch a fit. Hannah actually says that. And you might be a mother if you have ever gone through a car wash for entertainment, and I can tell you that's happened just in the last couple weeks in our house. So happy Mother's Day to all of you mothers. You, yes, we can applaud, yes. You have a very challenging and extremely important task, and we want to honor all you moms out there today. And the prize for you today for all of your hard work is a candy bar at the end of service. We have candy for the moms today as you walk out. Certainly you deserve a lot more than that, but that's what you get today. So I actually happen to be married to a very great mother, and I want to thank her today for all that she does and all her hard work. But happy Mother's Day to all of you. I had Jeff skip over one announcement there. It's the one that you have an insert about. And if you've read, ahead there, so I kind of inherited the position of president of the Madison area ministerium when Steve Frank moved away, and I got stuck with, blessed with that position. And anyway, so, you know, we've been trying, we kind of in the past, we just kind of sat around and drank coffee, and, you know, eventually you start saying, well, is there something we should be, are there things that we could be doing as a group? And, between the churches, you kind of figure two things, at least, that we all agree on. One is we all agree on serving other people, and we all agree on worshiping Jesus. And so this community cookout and worship service has come out of those conversations. All of the churches are going to participate. Slynn Park, Wednesday, June 2nd, 5:30 we'll eat, and 6:30 we will worship. And we have a bad weather backup date in there on June 9. So Minnesota Valley is bringing the worship team. We are in charge of organizing the food, not serving it. Faith is in charge of serving it. I could use a little help in organizing food if you're that kind of organizing type person. I have kind of begun the work on that and have some leads on some donations and so forth. But come and talk to me if you wouldn't mind being a part of that team. And then the rest of you just show up, right? So that's coming up. June 2nd. Wanted to thank Dallas for bravely stepping up here and preaching last week, his first time doing that. He did great. Loved those, especially your pharmaceutical points. That was hilarious. Anyway, thanks to Dallas and Jeff and Anna for covering me last Sunday. So you all allow me 4 vacation Sundays a year, and that was one of them. I usually try to take one right after the annual meeting because, with Easter, April's always a busy time, Easter, and usually we have our youth district blitz trip in April. And then also, May 1st is actually my work anniversary, so I have now been your pastor for 8 short years. And so, I don't know, just seems symbolic, so I ought to take some vacation. So that's what I was doing last week. But thanks for that and for those who covered. So grateful to God to be the pastor of this church. Love being pastor of this church. Well, we're going to continue our pattern of taking offering as you leave today, kind of what got adjusted during coronavirus. But let's go ahead and pray over that right now, if you'd join me in prayer. Lord, you keep moving us forward, and I do. I'm so grateful for this church body and the family that we are to each other. The intentional pursuing of you that is done here and seeking to put your teachings into action in our lives. And Father, we're imperfect. We don't do it perfectly. But there's a lot of good going on here too. And so I'm grateful for this church family. Also grateful for how you have provided for us so consistently. And we just pray again this week over the offering that's given today. For those who give, and as always, we ask that you would give us wisdom in how to use these dollars for the growth of your kingdom and for your good work in the world. And that is what you do, Lord. You do great work in this world, and you're always moving and always calling people back to the good plan that you have for them. Lord, we thank you for that. And on that note, we will stand and sing Glory to You now. Will you all join with me? Before I dismiss the kids, I wanted to say that today is not only Mother's Day, but it is also another very special day. You can hang tight for a second here, Anna. I'm declaring today, Sit by a Friend Sunday. I don't know if you paid attention to the governor's order this last Thursday, but one of the details was that in worship services, you no longer have to be just in household groups. You can sit in groups of 10. So I'm calling this Sit by a Friend Sunday, if you would like, when I dismiss the kids. If you would like to go sit by someone, which we have not done for a long time. Lisa has never sat by anyone but herself here at Calvary. Because she started coming after the coronavirus. You can do that today. Now, listen, not everyone may be comfortable with that yet. So, you know, before you go plop yourself down next to someone, kind of, you know, say, hey, you know. Thumbs up, thumbs down. We want to be sensitive to that. But this is going to be true going forward, and you may have also been aware that there are some even better changes coming in the future weeks. May that be so, and praise the Lord for that. But so, we're going to sing Family of God as I dismiss kids, and if you want to get up and do that, you can. So we're dismissing for Super Church, which is ages 4 through 4th grade, and nursery under that, of course. Kids, you may go, and you can all stay seated, but if you, or stand and move around, whatever, sing the Family God song with me, though. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Oh, part of the family of God. All right. All these little things that we used to take for granted, we'll celebrate them as they return. Good. Thank you, wife. Told you before, I often get these little moments where I feel like I'm a late night talk show, and Anna's, you know, the piano player behind, or whatever, the guy on the side. No. All right, we got a sermon to do today, as always. And I'm going to open my sermon on this Mother's Day with a parenting moment that I had this week, even though I'm not a mother, but I think mothers will relate. This comes from just yesterday. I was sitting at our kitchen table eating while my 8-year-old and 5-year-old daughters were out in the backyard playing. So the two most popular spots in our backyard with my girls are really not spots that any adult would have guessed would be popular. And I know I've described one of them to you before. It's probably the biggest eyesore section of our backyard. We have the second set of backdoor steps that no longer lead to a door. They just lead to the side of the house. So at one point they led to a door. And the stairway is still there, accompanied by a metal pole that I guess maybe held a railing at one point. That little stairway has had an awful lot of playing done on it, and the pole has a name. It's Mr. Pole. Mr. Pole is open at the top, and so he has really been well-fed over the last few years. Sunflower seed shells that are picked up underneath the bird feeder and dirt and leaves, whatever. Mr. Pole is well taken care of. I have some plans in my head with what I would like to do with that section of our yard, namely put a small deck there, but it's probably a good thing that that is really low on my priority list, because I can imagine what I would hear from our children if I ever talked seriously about removing Mr. Pole and covering up those stairs. So, second spot that my girls love to play in is behind our garage, between our yard and the neighbor's yard. There's a line of lilac bushes that, you know, designates the dividing line between the two yards. And there's this 5-foot section between the back wall of our garage and those lilac bushes, somewhat enclosed. So that space is called the tree fort. And my girls will talk to their friends about their tree fort, and I often get this little dad guilt because it's not a tree fort. It's, I always feel like I have to explain that, no, I didn't build them this really great tree fort. It's just a piece of dirt in between the grass and the bushes. But to be honest, I'm not sure that they would enjoy a real tree fort any more than they have enjoyed this little space back there, which, you know, is all the dirt that they could find and leaves for making potions and that kind of stuff. So as I was eating yesterday, I had this, I had a great view of the tree fort through our kitchen window, and I was enjoying watching my girls playing there. I watched them and tried to soak it in, and it made me smile. Maybe you can relate to this. It's also kind of hard not to feel a little sad in times like that, because I start thinking about how this is just temporary, these happy times of having young children playing in our backyard. Man, 8 years ago, this would not have been possible because they didn't exist, right? 8 years is not that long of a period of time. 8 years from now, when they are 16 and 13, it's likely that that tree fort is not going to see a lot of action. I guess that thought makes me sad. It's a temporary world that we live in. Calvary, things are always changing, and that's even when life is relatively stable. Life isn't always relatively stable. People go in and out of our lives, people move away, and of course we all know that any one of us, old or young, could die at any time. And that's pretty unsettling. But this is part of what makes the good news of Jesus good news. Dallas did a great job last Sunday getting us to think about how amazing heaven is going to be. I'm going to piggyback this morning on a little bit of what he said. He pointed out last week, and if you've been here a while, you know this is a favorite subject of mine as well, but Dallas pointed out that we can look at all the amazing things in this world and in this universe and then ask, how much more amazing will the things be that God has in store for us in heaven? And that's a totally legitimate question. Dallas said we can look at incredible things on this planet, like the mountains or whatever, and there's something in our heart that says there's something more. And I believe that's true. There will be more in heaven. I also love the picture that he showed of the redwood tree seeds and then the redwood tree that those seeds would one day become, and he compared the wrinkly dying seed body to our physical bodies, which eventually will become wrinkly and die. And Dallas said that if that seed knew what it was going to become, it wouldn't worry about its wrinkly dying body. And so we, as followers of Jesus, shouldn't worry about our wrinkly dying bodies, because Jesus has promised for us a far superior body and a far superior existence in heaven after we leave this world. This is good news. Another aspect of this good news of salvation available through Jesus to us and the heaven that it can lead us to is that heaven isn't just described as a superior life experience, it is described as an eternal life experience. For God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So, eternal life, I don't believe that there we will have the types of experiences like I had at my kitchen table yesterday. Now, I guess I don't know for sure that we won't change in heaven like children change into adults. Maybe there will be change involved. Who knows? The one thing that I do know is that we won't have to ever be sad about the idea of losing anyone in heaven to death like we might lose people here. So, in heaven, we're eternal. We talk a lot here, appropriately so, about the Bible's promises that heaven will be that place of no more tears, no more pain. But let's brainstorm for a moment now on what life in an eternal, unbroken world will mean for the relationships we will have with people there, as opposed to our experience in this temporary broken world we live in. Should be fun to think about. First of all, you got to take that word broken just right out of the equation. How many of our relationships on this planet are hindered or destroyed by the brokenness of things in this fallen world? Sin and selfishness have destroyed many an important relationship, that's for sure. And even for those who work hard at not having sin and selfishness describe us, there still are elements of sin within us that cause issues and troubles in our relationships. You know, we say something out of weakness or tiredness, you know, wounds somebody. We give in to a behavior that's not normally part of our life, and all it takes is that one bad moment to tear a hole in someone who was counting on us. There's an element of learning in all of this too, right? We need to learn as we mature how to treat people well, how to have healthy relationships, and that means that we're not going to always be doing it right as we go through that learning process. And then beyond that, there's just the standard human limitations in communication, right? Communication is hard sometimes. We think we're being understood, but we're not being understood. We're trying to understand, but we're not fully understanding, and this, you know, leads to breakdowns and frustration. Maybe we lash out. There's all kinds of brokenness in human relationships on this planet. But in heaven, we get to take that word broken out of the equation. God can't be with sin. The Bible's clear on that. We're all infested with it. And of course, this is why we needed Jesus to come pay the atonement for us, so that we could stand clean before God and even possibly be able to go to heaven. Only Jesus makes that possible. God can't be with sin, and so that means that there will be no sin in heaven. So take sin off the table in our relationships with other people in heaven. I'm thinking we almost have to completely redefine what a human relationship looks like in that scenario. A relationship between two people who have no sin or selfishness within them. A relationship that's completely other-focused, loving, caring, consistent. No more broken relationships. Wow. I really doubt that we will be done learning in heaven, but it seems that learning how to live with less sin should not be an issue anymore for us if there's not going to be any sin in heaven, so that learning curve goes away. And the Bible also indicates that our bodies are going to be quite different in heaven. Who knows the capabilities that they'll have? I would guess that some of the walls that hinder us in our communication with each other might come down, and intimacy might look totally different in heaven. And maybe we'll just know perfectly what each other's thinking Maybe we'll be mind readers. I don't know. I think the Apostle Paul was saying something along these lines in 1 Corinthians 13 when he wrote, "For now we see only an imperfect reflection as in a polished metal mirror, but then we'll see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known." Now, I think he's talking there about knowing God fully, just as God knows us fully right now. But it seems likely to me that if we're going to know God fully, we'll also be able to know each other in a much more full way than we can on the earth. All those saved by Jesus are called in the Bible God's children. And so we talk about, in fact, we sang about it just a moment ago, how we inherit a family when we come under Christ. We become brothers and sisters in Christ with each other. Part of what is going to be an awfully large family in heaven. The Apostle John was given a vision of this, and he wrote it down for us in Revelation chapter 7, where he said, "After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation and tribe, people and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, Jesus. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.'" I think loneliness is a function of this broken world that we live in. And when we get to heaven, that's not going to be an issue. There are going to be an awful lot of people there to get to know with this brand new intimacy that we'll be able to have with each other. A number of people that is too big to count. And all of those people will be offering to us sinless, healthy relationship, a relationship that cannot be ended by death. Pretty awesome. Really awesome. So yeah, it's going to be different in heaven. Very exciting. Well, part of the purpose of my sermon today has been to do what we just did, which is to explore this idea of what it might look like to live in an eternal world rather than in a temporary one. I have a second purpose this morning as well. So we've just seen that we have something to very much look forward to there in heaven, but we aren't in heaven yet. We're still living in the broken temporary place. So for the remainder of our sermon time now, I'd like to think along with you about advice that the Bible gives on how we ought to live while we're still in this temporary world. Advice that the Bible gives on how we ought to live while we're in this temporary world. A person could probably come up with lots of things to talk about here. I have three brief points to offer to you. All three of my points fit under a central idea that I want to explain now. Okay, so I'm at my kitchen table watching Maya and Greta dig holes in the dirt to put little stick flags into to hide food in for the upcoming make-believe storm. And I'm smiling. It's a happy moment until it hits me that this is just a moment in time. My girls won't do that kind of thing forever, and I begin to feel sad. Well, in a temporary world, that is what we get, right? Moments. We are collectors of moments, and none of us knows how big or small our collection will be. I could die tomorrow. So I have the moments that have come before, and I have this moment right now. That's what I've been given. I may not get another moment. Therefore, I would say that the moments that we are given in life are very important, each one of them. The central idea for the remainder of my sermon here today is this: we need to use well the moments we're given. We need to use well the moments we're given in life, and I would like us to reflect a bit on some of what the Bible has to say about this concept. Thought number one of three. We need to appreciate the moments we're given. We need to appreciate the moments we're given. I believe this thought can be found in the Bible, and in fact, I believe that one of the most important Old Testament figures of all, King David of ancient Israel, modeled this for us. King David did not write all of the Psalms, but he wrote many of them, and if you've read them, you know that David was an emotional guy. And I do believe that he appreciated the good moments he was given in life. And the evidence is there in the Psalms where he wrote down some of those moments of appreciation, almost like writing in a diary. Here are some examples. For this first one, I imagine King David lying out under the stars at night, gazing up at the sky, and then at some point writing these words from Psalm 8. Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You've set your glory in the heavens. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you've set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? You made them rulers over the works of your hands, put everything under their feet, all the flocks and herds, the animals of the wild, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea. Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. So there's David lying out, looking up at the stars and marveling at God and how God has ordered life. He was appreciating the moment, thanking God for it. How about Psalm 65? And here, I imagine David sitting on a hillside on a pleasant day, a hillside overlooking fields. And he writes this to God. You care for the land and you water it. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain. The grasslands of the wilderness overflow. The hills are clothed with gladness. The meadows are covered with flocks and the valleys are mantled with grain. They shout for joy and sing. Another moment of appreciation is found in Psalm 139, where David marvels that time at the amazing nature of the human body, a gift from God to all of us. And he wrote, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made." David took time to appreciate the gifts of God in this world. David also had experiences of God as he lived life, and he didn't just zip past those. He appreciated those moments. A couple of examples here. Being a king in that day and age meant warfare, and David had seen God's hand at work in the battles. Here's Psalm 18. The cords of the grave coiled around me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From his temple, he heard my voice. He reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock. Now, most of us don't fight battles in the way that David fought battles, but we do face different types of battles in our lives, right? And perhaps you have seen a rescue from God in your life, something where you could use similar to words to the ones that we just read, David expressing to thank and appreciate God for the moment that he saved you. And then here's a psalm where David expresses gratitude to God for meeting him in his prayer time. Psalm 16, I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. You make known to me the path of life. Now, David had many moments of struggle and despair even in his life, and he wrote about those things in the Psalms too. The Psalms of David are real words from a man living in this real broken world. But when the moments of joy came for him, he appreciated them. He wrote them out like Psalm 57, "My heart, O God, is secure. I will sing and make music. Awake, my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I'll praise you, Lord, among the nations. I'll sing of you among the peoples, for great is your love reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies." We, like David, need to appreciate the moments that we're given in life. People say we have to capture the moments, right? We might not be given another one in this temporary world. So capture this moment right now, and then capture the next one if you're given one, and so on and so on. Live the moments. Don't miss them. Life is short. Let's not allow the difficulties and the challenges that come along in our days, the stress, to cause us to miss the moment. Let's not allow the imperfections of other people to cause us to miss celebrating the good in them and celebrating the good moments we have with them as we remember that we too are imperfect. And then mothers on this Mother's Day, and just parents in general of young kids, parents of adult kids, grandparents, aunties, uncles, whatever. Remember that we are only given moments with the kids in our lives. Let's be patient with them when they're behaving in ways that frustrate us. Enjoy your kids. Appreciate the moments you have with them. And for all of us then, don't miss the good moments we're given in life. There are so many things to be thankful for. And I should emphasize that word thankful there. It's not just about feeling appreciation. It's about thanking God, the author of all those good things, expressing that appreciation to him, just as King David did. Thank God for the good moments. We appreciate them. So we're talking here about advice that the Bible gives on how we ought to live while we're in this temporary world. The central idea that we're pulling from the Bible today is that we need to use well the moments we are given in life. And point number one has been, we need to appreciate the moments we're given. On to point number two. Okay, so the Bible teaches that God's creation was originally a place of order and goodness and love, and then sin came in and turned it substantially into a place of disorder and evil and hate. The world broke. We've seen in previous sermons here at Calvary at how the Bible tells us that God, almost immediately after that first sin, even in the midst of pronouncing consequences for that sin, God also initiated a plan of redemption and salvation and healing for the world. It was a plan that was going to play out over a very long period of time. One of the central markers of that plan, of course, being the death of Jesus on the cross. A death that would bring about incredible healing, massive healing and restoration. So God has been about, since that first sin, trying to bring back order and goodness and love to the earth. Jesus, who is the picture of the character of God given to us, when he walked the earth, he took sick people and he healed them. Disorder back into order. He took demon-possessed people and kicked the demons out. Disorder back into order. Removal of evil. Replacing evil with good. Jesus taught people how to pursue goodness and battle against evil. He taught people to love and not to hate. Jesus was all about trying to restore order, goodness, and love. And those who follow Jesus today are also to be about that exact same agenda. And this is my second point. We need to use the moments we're given to bring order and goodness and love into our broken world. We need to use the moments we're given to bring order and goodness and love into our broken world. Every single day we have interactions with lots of people, and we have the ability to use those moments to try to bring some order, goodness, and love into the world through how we behave there. Or we can use that moment to bring into the world greater disorder, evil, selfishness, hatred, pain. We have a choice on how we use our moments. How do we do this well? Well, it's pretty simple. Learn from Jesus how he wants us to live and then actually seek to live those things out. Jesus brought life and light into the world. If we follow him faithfully, we'll do this as well. Jesus said to his followers in Matthew 5, You are the light of the world. So let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Here are some other thoughts from Scripture on how we ought to use the moments we are given to bring order, goodness, and love. Is anyone poor among you? Don't be hard-hearted or tight-fisted toward them. Rather, be open-handed and freely lend them whatever they need. Bear one another's burdens. Jesus said, "Love each other as I have loved you." Love must be sincere, it says in Romans 12. Hate what's evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in love, honor one another above yourselves, seek justice, defend the oppressed, take up the cause of the fatherless, plead the case of the widow, love your enemies, and do good to them. Heal the sick and tell them the kingdom of God has come near to you. And go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. You know, in a world full of biting speech, profanity, sarcastic talk, let's let our words be pure and life-giving. Gracious words are like a honeycomb, sweetness to the soul and health to the body, says in Proverbs 16. Each day when I drop my girls off at school and I say hi to Jessica Westby, I pray that God will protect them, right? Keep them safe and healthy. I also ask that he would use them to be light in that school that day, light for him. And we can bring light too, right? Bring joy into your interactions with people. Bring fun, good, clean fun, okay? Bring a smile on your face and bring Jesus on your lips. Be light. And then back to mothers and, you know, dads too, and grandparents and so forth. Hey, you know what? When you use the moments that you are given with kids to seek to bring order and goodness and love into their lives, you do double duty. Because if you're bringing order, goodness, and love into the lives of kids, not only will you have succeeded in using your life moments there wisely, but there's a good chance that they will turn around and also seek to bring order and love and good out into the world during their lifetime. That's your efforts multiplied. That's very important work. And by the way, disciplining your kids is actually part of bringing order and goodness into the world. I said before, we all have to learn how to treat people well, have healthy relationships. Proverbs 13:24 says, "The one who loves their children is careful to discipline them." And we need to teach our children God's ways. Ephesians 6:4, "Bring your children up in the training and the instruction of the Lord." So teach and train and discipline, but also balance that discipline with moment after moment after moment of showing great love. Use your moments with kids wisely. So how are we to live in a temporary world? We're to use well the moments we're given. And one way in which we can do that is by using our moments to bring order and goodness and love into the broken world we live in, just as Jesus did. Last point to cover, and it is this. I believe that as Christ followers, we ought to view each moment that we have in life not as an ending, but as a moving forward to an incredibly great goal. We ought to view each moment we have in life not as an ending, but as a moving forward to an incredibly great goal. And here I come back to the ideas we opened the sermon with, the sadness that we sometimes feel, even in the happy moments when we remember that these things are temporary, that they don't last and people die, and all these challenges of living in a temporary world. So if we truly believe what Jesus our Lord taught, that each moment we are given in this world, then each moment we're given in this world brings us closer to being in the situation that we desperately all want to be in, an eternal world with no brokenness and no chance of losing the relationships that we love. And if we truly believe what Jesus our Lord taught, then each moment that passes in this world brings those that we love, assuming they're also following Jesus, closer to being in the situation that they desperately want to be in, an eternal world with no brokenness and no chance of losing the relationships they love. It's all this is moving towards that goal, and that's an incredibly great goal. And I think this idea should help us take those moments we have of sadness and transform them. It should allow us to adopt the same viewpoint as the Apostle Paul had, who wrote, "One thing I do, forgetting what is behind, straining toward what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Paul may have been very good at appreciating the moment. I'm not sure, like our first point. He was for sure really good at doing our second point, using his moments to bring good and order and love into the world. But he didn't get stuck there. Paul also saw each moment of his life not as an ending, but as another step closer to attaining the ultimate goal of reaching heaven. And if we have that view of things, I think we should be able to shift in our moments of sadness about the temporary nature of this place. We should be able to relax a little bit about things and just enjoy the process. Enjoy the ride of life at each step. Or at least maybe we can let the process play out and go through it with a peace in our hearts. And even when we get old and our bodies start to break down, or we're still young and our bodies start to break down and we aren't enjoying the ride of life as much as we used to, even then, every moment we have is a step towards the goal of not having to deal with brokenness and pain anymore. And we remember Paul in 2 Corinthians 4, "Therefore, don't lose heart. Though outwardly we're wasting away, inwardly we're being renewed day by day, for our momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all." The Bible doesn't promise heaven to those who are still rebelling against him. And if that's you here today, I implore you to get your life right with God. Capture the moment today and do that, because we don't know how many more moments we will have. And if the loved one that you're thinking about right now, thinking about losing someday, isn't following Jesus with their lives, first, make sure that they've had the good news of Jesus explained well to them, that they've had the opportunity to learn and turn to him. If they have heard, but they've rejected Jesus to this point, then pray and pray some more and love and nudge. Overwhelming them with the message probably isn't going to do you any good. Beating them over the head with the message probably isn't going to do you any good. But I'd say on occasion, bring the subject up in love. Speak truth in love. Love, nudge, pray, repeat. All right, mothers and fellow parents, and really just anyone in general, when you have those moments like the one I was having at my kitchen table yesterday, and you start thinking about how circumstances will change in life, and that the things and people you love in this world will come to an earthly end, I think it's okay to feel some sadness about that. But then I think we ought to do three things. Number one, appreciate the good moments that you have in your life, the ones you have had, the good moments that still come, maybe even the moment you're having right then. Thank God for those things. Number two, resolve yourself to use that moment and each remaining moment that you're given in life to try to bring order, goodness, and love into this world. And then number three, remember that the moment you're having right then doesn't have to represent an ending. It can represent a moving forward to an incredibly great goal, reaching heaven. So yeah, I treasure these days with my wife and my lovely and creative young daughters. I'm trying to appreciate the moments, watch them play, thank God for them. I know that my kids won't always be in the backyard playing, and that does make me sad, but because of Jesus, I can shift from that emotion into the thought that Anna and I, and my girls too, if they would continue in their faith as they come of age, we are on a journey moving forward towards no longer living in a temporary situation, but living in a world where we'll be able to experience each other and so many others in a way far deeper than we even know each other now, without sin or brokenness to cause heartache, and without the ability to ever lose each other again. That's a goal. Worth looking forward to. Good news for people living in a temporary world. Would you pray along with me? Lord, I do wish, as we all do, that I could keep the things and the people that I love here forever, hold tightly to them and all the good things that are in this world. But that's just not the situation we have here. But your word tells us there's coming a day when that situation will be different. No more death, tears, pain, sadness. You've promised heaven to those who return to you in submission. And we thank you. What a hugely important hope this is for our lives. Thank you, Jesus, for making it possible. And we look forward to that day. Living life to the full and looking forward to the goal. Amen. We're getting to the end of our requested favorite hymns. In fact, we've gone to some folks have given me more than one, so we're doing another one from Lisa Thompson today. Another great hymn, Fairest Lord Jesus. Why don't you stand and sing with me? It's hymn number 188, if you want to use your hymnals, 188. And it's on the board as well. Fairest Lord. Glory, joy, and Don't forget your candy bars as you leave. There's also an offering plate in the back if you are giving today. And thank you for that. And now may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen. Thanks for being here today. God bless you.